What is the truth about weight loss? You know, there is, I'm not so sure that there is just one particular answer to that, but I do know that there is a whole heck of a lot of misinformation that is floating around in the ethosphere, as it were. And so my guests today are two people who are working tirelessly to really clear up that confusion and get to the bottom and answer that question, what is the truth about weight loss? And I'm so privileged to be joined today by Chef AJ. Thank you so very much for being here.
Oh, thank you, Chuck. It's always a pleasure talking to you.
And Toby Vywolfen, who is making his Exam Room podcast debut. Thank you so very much for being here, Toby.
Well, I'm excited. Can't wait to talk to you. Thanks for having us.
And as people are watching this, as people are hearing this, you are really in the midst of this all-encompassing summit that really gets to the bottom, as I said, about the truth of weight loss. And AJ, I mean, we're talking about 40 or so of the world's leading obesity experts who will be speaking at this?
Yeah, I'm so excited, really. And this year, including a childhood obesity expert, too, because we feel that even though children probably aren't going to watch the summit, their parents will. So we're really excited to get one that can specialize in childhood obesity.
That's huge. As a matter of fact, I was just having a conversation the other day with Dr. Yami, and she's a pediatrician, plant-based, and she and I were talking about, you know, why is it that, you know, children are having such a hard time now struggling with their weight? And then even going so far as to take the conversation to, well, we think that as kids, we're invincible, and parents think the same way as well, that, you know, we can eat whatever we want right now and there will be no penalty. But by the time that kid reaches 20, 30, 40 years of age, they have to pay that toll for the cheeseburger they're eating in fifth grade.
Yeah. I think, you know, there's so many moments of the summit that stuck with me, but I remember when she said that sometimes she'll have a very young child that is so obese, they can't get up on the table by themselves. And to see them struggle, she says, it just breaks her heart.
Toby, I want to turn to you because this was your brainchild, essentially. And so when you hear, I mean, you look like such a fit individual. And so when you hear about a child who's struggling with their weight so much, why did you feel compelled to get involved and to kind of bring this message forward?
There's all kinds of reasons to it, obviously. The health aspect as well. I've personally never struggled with my weight, but I had the privilege of living in the US for a year with a great host family. And I remember they all were struggling with their weight. And we were talking about kids. One of the sons there in the family at 11 years old, he was like, almost like a barrel running around. And it was just so heartbreaking to see. He was obviously being mocked in school, being teased. It's so heartbreaking. And to know, once I started working in this field, to understand how companies target kids, which is something that we'll dive into in the summit as well, how difficult it is to even get off those foods in a sense, because they're so addictive. And we have this year for the first time one of the experts sharing MRI scans of what happens in our brains when we eat those foods. And kids being kind of the weakest, if parents, especially like you said, they maybe say, okay, you know, they're invincible, let them run with it, they enjoy the food, at least they're eating something. And then before we know it, the biology changes, they might be damaged for life. So something has to be done. And once I had the opportunity to do something, I'm just thrilled to be partnering with AJ to bring everyone to the summit and spread the word.
Yeah, I am fascinated by the idea of those brain scans. Being a food addict myself, I will never say that I'm a former food addict. I think, you know, just like with any other substance that you've battled, you know, once an addict, always an addict. So recovering. But I feel like when I would eat that fast food that I craved so much every single day, that my brain, when I would get a chance to eat it, would light up like a Christmas tree. AJ, is that kind of what these brain scans are going to show?
Absolutely. Because, you know, even though I'm plant-based myself and most of the speakers happen to be plant-based, we have people on that are just researchers in the field of food addiction that are going to show this to you, that it's going to blow your mind that the same part of the brain gets hijacked. It lights up. And yes, it may not be as grave as, say, heroin addiction in terms of the consequences, but it can be for some people. People do lose their life to food addiction, maybe not so much directly, like getting behind the car and getting into an accident, but by the diseases that it causes, like diabetes, for example.
No question about it. And people do. I mean, you look at what is it right now? You know, 43% of Americans are obese and more than 3 out of 4 are overweight. So you're talking about a huge issue that still I don't think is being talked about nearly enough. The fact that there's a reason why you see a McDonald's on every other corner. It's because these foods are created. And it sounds such like a conspiracy, but the foods are created for you to crave them more and more and more and more. It's just that perfect combination of fat and salt and sugar. And it just lights up that brain. And it's like, I want more. For me, you know, I will tell you, and you can speak to this a little bit as well, as far as kicking the habit. But for me, it was way easier to quit smoking than it ever was to put down the 7-layer burrito from Taco Bell.
Oh, I agree. We talked about this before. You were more of the fat salt guy. I was more of the sugar fat girl. But I used to smoke too, believe it or not. And I'm asthmatic, and smoking was a piece of cake compared to giving up the piece of cake.
I bet. And Toby, how much you live right now in Germany? I'm curious, how much more does the average American eat, like fast food, the McDonald's, the Burger King, thing like that? How much more is eaten here compared to the typical German diet?
Yeah, it's a good question. Obviously, the typical diet almost around the world is becoming more and more convenience food and fast food. So that's changing as well. That being said, I do feel that the American culture is more innovative in that sense, and there's positives and there's some negatives to it as well, obviously. And the world kind of adapts many, many of those innovations. So while we're not there yet, it is going to that place where you see, you know, people driving to McDonald's for the drive-through and just eating in their cars, or we have bakeries. So our Subway is replaced by local bakeries, and people, you know, just queuing, getting a sandwich, and on their way they go. No veggie in sight. So it is very similar. It's not there in that sense, but the availability that you addressed is also one of the tactics, and one of the speakers is going to address what tactics those companies use and making food available, readily available, like almost putting it in our faces, right? It just triggers that that instinct that we have as a animal to consume those foods. So it's very, very fascinating, and so many aspects in this summit that touch on getting to the core of the problem, which isn't the person, but it's most always the environment.
Yeah, we're going to peel back a few of the layers of that onion here during our conversation today, getting to the truth about weight loss. But I want to stick with your trip to America, go back to that for a second. How jarring was it to see the difference? I know that you said that they're kind of similar, but for the first time that you stepped foot in this country and you began eating that standard American diet for a year, you know, how jarring was that for you, to your body, to adapt to that?
Yeah, I think I remember the first night I was in the US, we ordered a gigantic pizza. I've never seen a pizza that big. You know, it comes in those square boxes. It's a square pizza. You know, in Germany, we are lucky to have Italian influence come over with their style of pizza, but the American pizza, you know, big and square, and the whole thing was gone. And I think we ordered 2 or 3 for the night and watched some wrestling on TV. So it was like full immersion first night. And I just thought to myself, oh man, this is going to be different. And then in the school cafeteria, you know, the pizza trend continued, but they had a salad bar, and I think I was the only one trying to pick something from the salad bar, but they didn't have any, you know, like variety. It was more like a side thought. It wasn't even focused on, and there weren't any nice dressings. And I think I had to stick to one dressing that was semi-okay for basically the whole year in school. So by the end, you get tired of it. And if I were to think, you know, like I had to do this for not just 1 year, but many, many years, I can totally see why the kids in school, they go to, you know, like they pick those burritos, or they pick the pizza or the burger or the fries. It's much tastier than the options that are available.
Pizza and wrestling. I mean, that was, you're speaking to the heart of the old me right there. I mean, that was my jam. Goodness gracious. We have a doctor working with us, Dr. Vinita Raman at the Barnard Medical Center. She's on the show very frequently, and she tells a story about immigrating to the U.S. from India as a young child, not quite a teenager, and just how rapidly she put on weight by adopting that standard American diet, eating those sugary, high-fat foods that just were not at all in her in the culture over in India before she came here, and how difficult it was to kick that habit later in life.
Yeah, I remember I asked for oatmeal because that's what I grew up on, and there wasn't any oatmeal that my family could find or purchase that didn't have sugar in it. You know, like the I guess now you can find Quaker oats, the sugar-free ones, and Whole Foods and all that. But we were out in the outskirts, food deserts, if you were to call it like that. And I literally, you know, like I was sieving through the oatmeal to get the sugar out, because my parents always ingrained in me, don't eat too much sugar. So, you know, like having to sieve out the sugar from the oats. I mean, that's how it starts, right?
Oh, yeah. And you're right. I mean, the little oatmeal packets, you know, the blueberry, the cinnamon swirl, the, you know, maple flavor, which doesn't even have any maple syrup. It's just all brown sugar, basically. I mean, it's just, it's insane to me. And yet, oatmeal is still on those boxes, those packets, you know, still pushed as a healthy breakfast, you know, heart healthy. So, it just seems so crazy to me. AJ, before I was this morning, I was going through, I was like, all right, well, what do we want to talk about during this interview? So I started to pull up some statistics, and I came across one that's been quoted quite a bit. And it is that 95% of diets fail. All right. People attempt to lose weight, and then inevitably they fail at it 95% of the time, or at least that success is not sustained. Why is it that these popular diets, the Jenny Craigs, the Weight Watchers, the keto diet, South Beach, I mean, we could name them for days. Why is it that there is such a high failure rate with them?
Yeah. And it's funny because when I Google that, sometimes I get as high as 98% fail. And we actually have at least three experts on the summit that are going to address that. And one of them is Dr. Joel Fuhrman, who basically has said, if what you're doing isn't sustainable, it won't be permanent. So in other words, the problem with diets are that people go on a diet. If you go on something, ostensibly you're going to go off it. And so one of the things that all the speakers recommend is to just stop dieting and just change your lifestyle, because you have to be able to continue to do what you did to lose weight in order to maintain that weight loss. And as a matter of fact, it probably has to even be stricter when you think about it, because as a smaller person, you require less calories. That's why we brought on this year Dr. James Hill, who was the co-founder of the National Weight Control Registry, who actually studies people like you and me that have successfully kept their weight off. And I'm a member of the registry. You should also apply if you can, Chuck, because they want to study the people that have kept it off and figure out what characteristics do they have in common. And he is going to reveal that. We also have Dr. Susan Roberts from Tufts University, who with James Hill now just founded the International Weight Control Registry, that's going to study people not just in the United States, but all across the world that have successfully kept the weight off. And the thing is that they're still doing the program that enabled them to lose the weight in the first place. The problem with keto, and this is one thing I'm so happy about on the summit, is even the speakers that weren't plant-based, they all basically said keto is a mistake. It's a horrible diet because it's a trick. It's the scale shows what looks like a weight loss, but it's not fat loss, because basically what you're losing is water. So you might lose 10 pounds the first couple of days and think, oh my God, this is a miracle. But the minute you eat carbohydrate, which which is what we're supposed to eat in any form, whether it's a vegetable or rice or a potato, the weight shoots up because you're now holding back onto that water, because for every molecule of starch or glucose, there's like 5 molecules of water. And so they're saying that this is not an effective strategy for sustainable weight loss. And slower weight loss actually seems to be better, at least when it comes to maintaining, because it gives you that time to learn the good habits that you have to maintain once you've lost the weight. And what people don't realize, which is unfortunate, is this thing called metabolic disadvantage or calorie penalty that a couple of the speakers, I believe Dr. Roseanne Alvier and Dr. Jamie Kane, an obesity specialist in New York, talk about, is that, and this is so unfair, but it's almost like we're punished for being overweight, in that when we lose weight, we require fewer calories than somebody at our exact weight that has never been overweight. It's not fair. Whether or not it completely corrects, the experts are not certain. But that's the thing. You actually have to almost be more diligent when you lose the weight than during your weight loss process. But if you don't continue what you did to lose weight, you're going to gain it back. And that's the problem with diets. And what I love is Dr. Roseanne Alvier did an amazing PowerPoint that showed why calorie counting always fails. So these weighing and measuring programs that facilitate quick weight loss, where people are counting calories, carbs, or points, yes, they work in the short term, but they backfire in the long term, not only causing you to regain the weight you lost, but more weight. And she will scientifically explain that once and for all.
And you will hear other experts, if you Google around and studies show, you know, well, what is the number one indicator that somebody will be gaining weight in the future? A lot of times that answer is being on a diet right now, you know, because of that high failure rate that we were just discussing. You know, two out of every three people who go on these diets, another study found that they actually regain more weight than they lost. So there you have that vicious yo-yo dieting cycle that gets us into this obesity epidemic that we're in currently. AJ, let me stick with you here for a second. I know that counting calories, not necessarily the biggest thing while eating a whole food plant-based diet. But again, you know, you look at how many calories the typical American eats during the day. Okay, the CDC will say for a man, it's roughly 2,500. That's still well above the 2,000 recommended. But they have women at 1,800. And so I kind of suspect that those numbers are a little bit skewed. I'm not sure that I buy into that, because others have done studies on this independently and found that the average caloric intake is 3,600. I would be more inclined to agree with the 3,600 number, given what the statistics are about people being overweight and being obese. And so that kind of brings me to this question, is how mindful does a person need to be about the food that they're eating, and how big of a blinder are they wearing right now, where they have completely blacked out the amount of fat and calories that they're eating every day?
Oh, I think people are wearing blinders because they want, as Dr. McDougall, one of the experts, says, people want good news about their bad habits. So they, you know, butter is back, butter in the coffee, coconut oil is good. They see these ads and these memes and they're like, yeah, this is what I'm going to do. So I think they're not really informed in nutrition. But then again, doctors aren't really informed in nutrition for the most part, except for the ones that are on this summit. And I think you're right that people are eating far more fat and calories than they did, you know, even 20 years ago, for sure. 50 years ago, they were eating less. And I think part of it is restaurant eating, fast food, like you say, and every corner, McDonald's, people are eating these kind of foods. And you're going to learn from Dr. Susan Roberts that these meals contain more fat and calories than some people need for an entire day. I kid you not. You could get a restaurant meal or a fast food meal that contains between 1,500 and 2,000 calories. And for a woman who is a little bit more mature and not very large, that's all you get for the day. And people are eating their entire calories in one meal.
Oh yeah. I mean, I was well over 2000. I think my $20 Taco Bell order was somewhere in the range of 5,000 calories. I can't even remember, you know, the amount of fat that was in it, but it was just staggering. And then after I lost weight, I got curious and I started, you know, going around to the most popular chain restaurants and looking at the nutrition facts that they have to publish by law about the items that are on their menu. And I will never forget, like, looking at Denny's, where I used to enjoy the chicken fried steak back in the day. And that thing, I mean, that was like well over 2,000. Like, that was like 3,000 calories by itself, not to mention anything else that you're going to be eating with it. And people don't realize this when they're sitting down to eat the chicken fried steak. It just blows my mind. Toby, let me ask you a question. At the top of the show, you said that you have never struggled with your weight, and yet we hear you talk today and you're so passionate about this. So why is it that you're so passionate about it? Where did this fire start burning for you?
Yeah, it's a good question. I honestly don't know. My dad is a nutritionist and he's been in the health space. Of course, I always said, nah, that's not cool enough. I'll find my own way. And then over many, many detours, I found my way back to a similar topic, now obviously in a different format than what he did. Yeah, I think something has to be done. You just see so many good people suffer. I know my host family, they were such great, generous people, welcoming, you know, like a stranger from Germany who's got a different culture, and just let me live with them for a year. And they struggle, right? They struggle. Back then, they had diabetes built. They were unable to pay for the gas. We went on a trip down to Florida over spring break back then with the family. And on the way back, their credit cards ran out. And well, knowing what I know now, I would say a lot about that credit card running out is medical bills, right? Having to pay for all the medication. And obviously, I helped out where I could. I asked my dad for emergency funds to get us all home. It's tough. And those people, they don't deserve it, right? It's not their fault. And I think that's what resonated so much with AJ's story when I had her on my own summit, the Plant Fit Summit that I started before this one. And she said that people need to realize it's not your fault. And that message needs to be shared. And the answers are luckily available, even though the mainstream media and the diet industry doesn't share them. But that's what we're trying to do. And obviously, along with it, hopefully help the world as well. So there's so many factors that go into it, but there's no shortage of passion.
Do you keep up with that family? Stay in touch with them?
Yeah, unfortunately not. That was before internet days. That was before social media. So I did Google their names. I try to find them, and I still connected with their neighbors. But even the neighbors moved to a different city now. So unfortunately, I'm not in touch with them. Yeah.
And really quickly, before we talk about one of the, what I feel is the most exciting aspects of the summit, I want for you, please, to share the story about how you first became introduced to the idea of eating a plant-based diet, because this is, you told us this story right before we started recording, and I was like, there's no way, this is so crazy. Go ahead and share that with us.
Sure. So after university, I went into renewable energy because I wanted to do something sensible. Which led me to live in Singapore, where I met my now wife. But the renewable energy business was shut down pretty much by the Kyoto Protocol not being extended. So then I was out of job, and I was basically living out of a suitcase somewhere between Germany and Singapore and traveling back and forth on tourist visas. And in one of those trips, my then girlfriend, now wife, introduced me to a vegan bodybuilder. And what are the odds of finding a vegan bodybuilder in Singapore? But we got talking, and I've always been passionate about obviously the environment as well as somewhat the health aspect from my dad's side. And I was curious, right? So he's just like, yeah, come, I'll show you. I got to show you Dr. Barnard. Have you heard of Dr. Barnard? I'm like, no, who's that, right? Okay, so then he showed me a video of Dr. Barnard talking about the link between dairy and cancer. And in my late teens, my mom had cancer and passed away. And it was just like a light bulb moment. I'm like, oh my God, this is crazy. How did I not know about it? Or how did even my dad, who obviously back then studied nutrition way before the discussion about a plant-based diet even being sensible or possible was happening. So, And then it's just like a light bulb moment. We got to get it out there. How do we get it out there? And I'm like, we're in Singapore, you know, like online is the only way to reach anybody because Singapore is so tiny and detached from the rest of the world. So We're like, hey, you know, like look around, there's a summit, let's do an online summit. And because I had been working in the online space for a while after, you know, like stopping the environmental aspect, I had to somewhat survive. And that's how it all started, basically. Figuring I can, if I can build websites for an agency, I can build a website with a purpose. And that's how the first summit started. And that's how I connected with Chef AJ a year later. And the rest is history.
Yeah, that's so cool that to think you are literally changing lives, potentially even saving lives, just because you happen to be introduced to a vegan bodybuilder in Singapore. I mean, just, life is so much fun. You know what? While Toby was speaking, AJ, I started to wonder, I was like, I wonder, because you have such a great weight loss story as well. I wonder if you then, after you had lost weight, went back and started to do some research on those menus that are at those popular restaurants. Have you ever gone on like a fast food website and pulled up the numbers and just had a jaw-dropping moment?
I have, because I teach classes with people, and one of the modules is about eating, how to eat healthfully anywhere when you travel or go to restaurants. And we always tell them, do your research in advance, because as you said, you know, a mom and pop restaurant doesn't necessarily have to have the nutritional information online. But my understanding is if a restaurant has at least three locations, they have to have it. And so I would pull up the menus, for example, of McDonald's and a very popular vegan restaurant called Veggie Grill. And when you look at their most popular sandwich, each place, it's 770 calories. So when people think, oh, vegan, it's healthier. Well, not if it's fast food vegan. Both of these sandwiches, which aren't very big, 770 calories, 60 grams of fat. And how much of that fat is saturated? Let's see. Probably like 20 grams of saturated fat. So people don't realize how much fat and calories are in these restaurant meals, which lack fiber, which are not very satisfying. And they can really pack on the pounds when you eat out at restaurants. Like, restaurants use more sugar, fat, and salt than you ever would at home. And we know that that is what's addictive, the sugar, fat, and salt. Dr. Goldhammer talks in depth about how these are not foods, sugar, fat, and salt. They don't exist in nature in any concentrated form. They're chemicals that fool our brain satiety mechanisms, cause us to overeat. And that's really the problem. If people ate whole natural food, they wouldn't be in this pickle that they're in now.
That's such an important point, though, that just because a food is vegan doesn't mean that it's healthy. I do worry with the increased popularity surrounding plant-based diets right now and the boom of plant-based products that you see on store shelves and fast food convenience restaurants that have plant-based items. I do worry that you're going to see more and more, vegan items that unfortunately then adhere to the standard American diet. As somebody who's so passionate about weight loss and healthy eating, a healthy plant-based diet, is that something, AJ, that you're also concerned with?
I am. And I get, you know, people that are ethical vegans, which, by the way, I am. I mean, 43 years, you don't do it for the environment. I never even heard about the environment when I was 17 or the health aspects. But they're like, well, you know, you're making it too hard for people to be vegan because you're telling them to actually eat food. The thing is one of the things experts agree on, whether they're plant-based or not, is that processed food really isn't food. Some people can get away with eating a little bit of it and maybe not be overweight or have a disease, but we're not supposed to eat food from a can, a box, a bottle, or a bag. And, you know, when you think about it, look, I'm for not eating animals, but our ancestors did eat animals, not to the degree they ate them today in the cruel ways that they're factory farmed, but they did. But one of the things that's really changed in the last 50 years, especially since World War II, is we didn't evolve eating processed food as a species. We're not supposed to be eating processed food. We're the only species, to my knowledge, that does, other than maybe perhaps domesticated dogs and cats. And we're the only species other than domesticated dogs and cats that suffer with weight because we're not eating the food that's intended for our species, which, by the way, if it is animal products, it's certainly not dairy. That's certainly not to the degree that we are eating it. So we need to get back to eating food. And so while I'm happy when people don't eat animals for any reasons, I think they can go down a very dangerous path when they rely on these vegan processed and convenient foods, which are just as addictive and delicious as their non-vegan counterparts. And until people understand the work of, say, Michael Moss or Dr. David Kessler in their books, that these foods are addictive, they're designed to be addictive, whether you struggle with your weight or not, most people are going to struggle with them. You know, you bet you can't eat just one, sugar, fat, and salt. You don't find that in nature, at least not together, and certainly not in any concentrated forms. And for me, it wasn't even about weight. When I read these books and found out that the processed food industry was purposely hijacking our brain chemistry and taste buds for that their profit, I stopped eating it just on principle because I don't want to be anybody's experiment. And it's just, I think that, you know, knowledge can empower people. But again, that addiction to it is so strong that even people that don't struggle with their weight, it is very hard to give up these hedonic, hyperpalatable processed foods.
Yeah. And so the brain winds up getting hooked on that fat, that salt, that sugar, but then your schedule also then begins getting hooked on the convenience of these ultra processed foods that are so readily available. And I think that a lot of times when somebody wants to explore eating a healthy plant-based diet, they are kind of at a loss when it's time to go in the kitchen and to learn how to cook. That's kind of the cool thing about this summit this year is kind of new is like, not only do you have these experts, you know, these doctors telling you about the latest science, but some of them are actually stepping into the kitchen themselves and practicing what they preach.
Right. It's so exciting because, you know, it's Toby and I last year did another summit called The Truth About GI Health, because we found that a lot of people were telling us after the second Truth About Weight Loss Summit that their obstacle, well, they said their number one obstacle was the food. They didn't know how to make it. They didn't know how to cook it, didn't know how to make it delicious. But their other obstacle was that they had a lot of GI problems that made it hard to eat vegetables. So we did a summit in between and we found out that the same thing that is good for weight loss is good for GI health. And so it's not like these doctors are going to tell you things that are different than if you had heart disease or diabetes or GI health. That what is good for your overall health is going to be good for your GI health. It's what's going to be good for weight loss. And so at the GI Health Summit, we actually had a doctor, a gastroenterologist, Dr. Edwin McDonald in Chicago, who is a trained chef, and he did a cooking demo, and it was so popular. And we thought, well, let's get more doctors in the kitchen, because if they can see their doctor can cook, maybe they'll be inspired. So instead of having just three cooking demos, we have a cooking demo every day. We end the day with a cooking demo, so we have nine. And of course, we brought back some of our favorite chefs, but most of the cooking demos are done by doctors, and not all of them went to culinary school. And the idea is you have this doctor, he or she is busy, but they can show you how to make a delicious meal that isn't complicated, that you don't have to have gone to culinary school to make. And I think it's really inspiring watching the doctors cook.
I think so too. And I think that as somebody who then is exploring this and wants to get in touch with their health, to see a doctor do this, you know, there's a whole lot of confidence that comes with that. So I think that that is really unique and an important aspect of the summit, which, by the way, is February 13th through 21st. Toby, you're a web developer. Would I be correct in assuming that you put this website together yourself?
Yeah, I'm a one-man production crew. Yeah.
I feel your pain, my friend, but you know what? You are to be commended because it is such a fantastic website. I want to go through here before we wrap up. And here we go. Look at some of the speakers that you have at the conference. And I will tell you, AJ, just looking at the lineup here for day one, I mean, you are leading with some heavy hitters like Dr. Joel Fuhrman close to the top of the list there. That's incredible.
Yeah, he comes back too on the last day.
And then you come down to day two, Dr. Hanna Kaliova, she's doing some phenomenal research here recently. Matter of fact, I'll be speaking with her and Dr. Neil Barnard about this new study that they just put out looking at vegan and Mediterranean diets and which is better for weight loss. So that'll be an interesting conversation. By the way, I'll be on the summit on the second day as well. And thank you both so much for having me for that. And then Dr. McDougall will be there and Cyrus Kambada, I mean, for Mastering Diabetes. There's just so many wonderful people who are going to be taking part in this summit. And AJ, if somebody wants to register, where do they go?
Oh, they go to thetruthaboutweightloss.org. We can provide you with a link if you like. They can click and just boom, and it's free.
You can't beat that price. And we'll drop a link to that also in the episode notes. So go ahead and register today. Absolutely free. 9 days full of just life-saving, life-changing information.
And prizes.
What's that?
Prizes.
And prizes. That's right. And prizes, right? So let's make it fun and healthy.
Instant Pot donated 3 Instant Pots and 3 air fryers, and we're giving away 4 bottles of California balsamic vinegar every day because we actually interact live. Even though the interviews, of course, they have to be pre-recorded, we're interacting live the whole time the summit is being delivered through the chat feature and in between the episodes.
That's great. And the interactivity. So if somebody has a question during the summit, they can just throw it right in the chat box. You'll be there. You can field it. You can help them out. This is fantastic. What a great concept. And thank you both so very much for being here, talking about this, sharing your stories. It's just remarkable the way that you are using your own journeys now to help the lives of thousands of others. My hat is off to you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If you feel like you've raised your health IQ by a couple of points, go ahead and subscribe to this channel and leave a nice comment below. And to hear the entire interview, head over to Apple Podcast or wherever you get your shows from and subscribe to The Exam Room by the Physicians Committee. And please leave a 5-star rating.